Well, it's Wednesday night in the Word, and we are so glad that we get to host tonight and be with you.
Hi, everyone. It's good to see you tonight.
We pray that you are blessed, that you would know how high and wide and long and deep the love of Christ is for you. And while it's secondary, I pray that you would know also the love of Chris and Kristen for you. Mm-hmm. We really do enjoy these times with you.
Yes, we do.
It's a joy when I get to see you. So we're thankful for you. I was in the Word this morning, and I received a phone call just right before I came here tonight from somebody that had just recently attended a funeral here at the church. And they just said, I just feel like I need to seek the Lord more in my life. Can I talk with you about that sometime? Which I'm delighted to. And I guess I wanted to say to all of you tonight, Isaiah chapter 55 is such a promising passage. Listen to what it says in verse 6. Seek the Lord while he may be found, and call upon him while he is near. In other words, God issues an invitation that we can seek him. And when we seek him, we'll find him when we seek him with all of our heart. And I just want to encourage you in that. And maybe I'm just going to put my sweet wife, Kristen, here on the spot. But what are times where it's sweetest when you seek the Lord, where you just feel like you can really meet with the Lord?
Times of the day?
Yeah.
Always in the morning.
Yeah.
Because it's quiet. So I hear him more. I can focus better, but
yeah. So you just kind of start your day off.
Yes, but there are times.
Do you have a pattern?
Day.
What do you do in the morning?
Well, I usually wake up and stumbly try to get out of bed.
Yeah.
I'm not a morning person, but I get my Bible out and I usually try to read also a book. Like right now, I'm reading Trusting God by Jerry Bridges, in addition, and just take notes and spend that time with him. It's really good.
It's the right way to start it, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is.
So I just wanted to encourage you tonight. It's a Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. And this is a night where we can seek the Lord. And we're going to seek him together as we study Genesis chapter 9. And we're going to just be in the Word. We're going to have some worship tonight. We're also going to have some fun. And I think it is important to recognize and realize that it's a church family, just like a family at home. It's good to play games together. Mm-hmm. It's one of our favorite things. There's not many days we don't play a game.
Yes, that's true.
In fact, usually during this last year where we've worked from home more, I've worked from home more, I've had a turkey burger
for lunch
pretty much every day.
Almost every day.
It's been 362 days or 3 days since this all really
full-blown.
Right. I don't know if you realize, but we are coming up on the one-year kind of anniversary of the lockdown.
Yes.
And since then, I have seriously had at least 300 turkey burgers for lunch.
At least.
At least. Probably more every day.
Yes, yes. You never get tired of them.
And 350 bowls of oatmeal.
Yeah, that's for sure. Yes, indeed.
It's exciting.
And so usually when we sit down for lunch, we'll
play a game,
two of us.
Yeah, just play a game.
Yeah, it's
card game
fun.
Or dice or whatever. But we're going to do some of that tonight, too. We have Minute to Win It game, and we have some fun updates around the campus. But we really wanted to encourage you tonight. The Lord loves you. He loves to meet with us, which is amazing to me. I had opportunity to teach the high schoolers last night. And, just this idea of Romans chapter 5, that because of our justification, God's declaration of our righteousness by faith, through faith in Jesus, we have access to God. Like, we can approach the throne of grace with boldness and confidence. It is the greatest privilege you'll ever have on this earth, that you can actually enter God's throne room, the temple veil tore in two, and have relationship with the living God. And I just pray you're encouraged by that tonight, if nothing else, that this is a time just to seek him and to seek him together. Well, one of the things we like to do on Wednesday nights is just give a little update of what's going on around Grace Chapel. And so we call this Around Grace in 60 Seconds. So let's see if I can pull this off. Well, we're excited to tell you that Teresa Stockton has made it up to her new home in her sister, and we are so proud of you, Teresa. I'm sure you're watching tonight. We love you. Saturday night, we had a chance, the whole church, to pray over her, and we will miss you, but
yes,
we're thankful for God's provision.
Yes.
Casey Boyette is grateful, at least we get some of these off of Facebook, that her kids haven't quite grown out of the baby toys, and she said, what a savings.
Oh,
what's really
so
exciting
sweet.
is that they have an opportunity to take in a foster child.
Oh,
and so there's baby toys that have come in,
right.
And I got to see and meet that little baby last night, and what a joy. Debbie Ellis, somebody that's faithful at our church,
look
was showing
that.
Off her festive homemade mask that she made for St. Patrick's Day.
I love it.
Debbie,
that's
thank you
great.
For your contribution to our community. But today is St. Patrick's Day. That's part of the news. The other thing is that the Wilson family, Andy, Adam, and Sarah, were celebrating Janice, their wife and mom's birthday. So happy birthday to Janice.
Happy birthday, Janice.
What a great family picture, but I know it's a little old because he has hair on his head. Susan Bertner is enjoying some time with her horse, Jack. And this is a great little video. I love this. Susan actually rescues horses, and it's just a noble work and a wonderful lady. And she actually was gracious enough to give a young girl in our church lessons that we got to take for that. So thank you for that. Oh, and then I also, Josh Stegner, actually was a human jungle gym. There's Josh with his kids on him. And he was working at Awana last night and just is a great dad. He's on our elder board, but I love that picture. And what I'd love to see them do is recreate that in about 10 years.
Yes, there you go. See how that goes. That's a great dad thing to do.
And we're also excited. The Grace Resource Center food drive was a huge success. The church family was asked to bring in canned food this last week to help replenish Grace Resource Center, and you really came through. And then last night, youth group and Awana, they meet on Tuesday nights, and I had a chance to go and teach last night. That's a picture of me and my granddaughter, Willa. In Awana, and then also I got to teach youth group. I think I got a picture with a couple of the youth leaders. And notice we all have on the Anchor sweatshirts. So we were matching last night. It's kind of the uniform, I think, for the workers there. But what a great joy. Our youth group has just about doubled in size this last year, and they were hungry for the word. And then finally, I have a little video of the game time in Awana last night. I thought you might like to see all the kids running around the gym. And actually, the little girl that's hopping along right there is my granddaughter, Ellie. You can see her.
You can tell she was making eye contact with you.
And just a great time. Josh and Sam have done a great job continuing to lead our kids, but it was a great celebration. Awana last night. We're thankful for all of the families. So that's around Grace Chapel in 60 seconds.
Pretty good. I don't know if it was 60 seconds, but it was pretty good.
It felt a little longer than that, but nonetheless, there's
a lot. It was worth it. It was worth it.
That's all just in 1 week of the life of the church.
So wonderful. So we have some birthdays this week.
All right. Tell us who they are.
I just want to say happy birthday to Jody Contreras, William Labrado, Hugo Schreier, Mary Conkle, Nick Morris, Andrew Choate. Debbie Kuhn, Devin Leonard, which they're moving back soon. Millie Sadler, Lorraine Schaum, John Zegan, Pat Bradley, Beth Hawley, Brittany Long, Rita Smith, and our very own CJ Johnson.
CJ Johnson's birthday is Friday.
Yes, indeed.
Well, happy birthday to everybody. Mm-hmm. We really do love you. We're grateful for you. And we have a little quiz for you tonight.
Yes, we
Let's
do.
Have some fun.
Guess what theme it is. I bet you can't guess.
St. Patrick's Day.
Yes. Now, by the way,
you
didn't wear green today.
There's a reason we didn't wear green.
And I had green on earlier.
But there is green in the room.
Because
it's a green screen behind us. And if we wore green, you wouldn't be able to see
us. That's right. Now, unfortunately, I haven't have to pinch you.
If you pinch me, I'm going to kiss you back. Right here.
Oh, there we go. Because I have green eyes, so I get away with that. I can do that.
And you're my wife, so I get away with kissing you. So perfect. All right, here's the quiz.
All right, so don't forget to write in to, what is it again?
Live.
Live.
We've been doing this for a whole year now.
I know, but I
Live at gclancaster.com.
I have a block in my brain of
It's on the screen.
Oh, there you go. Live at gclancaster.com.
Here we go. $10 Amazon gift card.
Okay, number one, people traditionally wear green on St. Patrick's Day to avoid what?
Getting kissed?
Getting. I was trying to get another kiss.
Getting pinched.
Yeah. Getting pinched.
I think these people would think we've done plenty of kissing tonight. All
right. Okay, number two. How many leaves does a clover need to be considered lucky?
I don't believe in luck. I believe in providence.
Yes, I do. But when you were a little kid, did you ever try to search for?
I think we know the answer to this.
Four.
Here it is.
Four. Did you ever try to find one? I always tried to look for one.
Oh, yeah, I always did. Yeah, there were little weeds in our front yard.
Yep. According to one myth, what might you find at the end of the rainbow?
Oh, how funny. You know this. A leprechaun and a pot of gold.
Yes.
You know what I remember about rainbows? Do you remember the last Christmas Eve outdoor service that we had? And right at the end, it was kind of starting to rain.
Yes.
And just then this rainbow, because we did it earlier, just came over our whole entire church campus, and it was just unbelievably beautiful.
Yes, it was. It really was.
I think it was a reminder of God's faithfulness to us.
I know.
We're going to talk about the rainbow tonight. in Scripture in Genesis chapter
9. Perfect. So good timing. Perfect. Yeah. Okay, now last one, number 4. What dish is commonly eaten on St. Patrick's Day in America and Ireland?
And what I want to know is if you had this for dinner tonight, because then I'll know you're really Irish. What is it?
Yeah. Okay, the answer is corned beef and cabbage. Now, I thought the answer might be Lucky Charms. And Di and Dan Hebel sent me a box of those with a cute t-shirt to celebrate.
You got a Lucky Time Charms t-shirt,
didn't you? Yes, because that is my favorite cereal.
That is so funny. That is really funny. Thank you for that. That's kind. But the truth is, my wife does love Lucky Charms.
I do, and I really appreciate the gift.
So tell us if by any chance you happen to have that for dinner tonight, mm-hmm. or if you're Irish.
Yes, that'd be interesting.
Well, we have a fun Minute to Win It game, and then actually we have some really, really neat men's and women's videos tonight as well. Mm-hmm. Debbie Lewis and Weston Pursley will be on. But first, let's go to our Minute to Win It.
Good evening, Grace Chapel family. We're the Lowbys. We've been going to Grace Chapel for about 9 years now. My name's Scott.
My name is Whitney.
I'm Macy.
I'm Paisley.
I'm Weston.
I'm Gannon.
I'm Paxton.
Fun fact about us, we are
the loudest house on the block.
Hi, Grace Chapel family. My name is Ryan Johnson, and I am at the Masters University right now. A fun fact about me is I am addicted to these spicy chicken noodle, I don't even know how to say the name, bowls. Eat them for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. It's kind of weird. But Scott Lobby family, I'm coming after you. It was fun to see you guys at Hume Lake. Let's see what we can do here.
Good job.
Which is so good.
Well, that was a lot of fun.
That was. Good job, Ryan. Good try.
Good job. Good job. Couldn't help but root for our boy, but we sure do love the Lobby family.
Yes, we do.
Such a blessing. Mm-hmm. We're proud of you guys. it was the whole 97-27. We went right down. We should have been doing that with him.
We should have, yeah. Oh, well.
So I love the people. So yes. Mary, Cliff and Mary had corned beef and cabbage tonight. And Jessica Cox, who's been doing youth ministry at our church for 13 years.
Wow.
It's remarkable. I got to talk with her a little bit last night. Corned beef tonight. So that's kind of fun. And it looks like somebody else, the Vienna Wavers, are having Lucky Charms treats for dessert
that
tonight.
That sounds wonderful.
Not a bad idea.
I know.
We'll have to swing by these homes, have some dinner and dessert. Well, we are always privileged, and it's been a particular joy. You know, I think sometimes we talked about this at the beginning of this whole year, that we were going to look for the silver linings, look for those things that God was really doing in the midst of, you know, what was difficulty. And I think when we do that, we rejoice, we are grateful, and we should always be. And it kind of helps our own spirit, but it gives glory to God. Mm-hmm. And one of the silver linings I think has been is we've gotten to know a lot more people in the congregation. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because typically you'll maybe go to a service in a small group and sit at the same small group table on Wednesday nights in men's or women's Bible study. But we've heard so many testimonies over the last year, so many different people teaching. And what, one of the comments I've gotten is how many people have enjoyed getting to know pastors' wives, even through announcements.
And, yes.
And so it's really been a good thing. And tonight we will be blessed as well because you're going to get a chance to hear from Debbie Lewis, who proved to be a very effective teacher during women's Bible study.
That's right.
She
really
did a great job. Mm-hmm. And then Weston Pursley is our youth pastor, and he's going to kind of do our men's ministry segment. And then right after that, Pastor David McCoy is going to share from Genesis chapter 9 tonight. So get your Bibles out. But let's enjoy these testimonies and then a time in the Word together.
Grace Chapel family. Pastor Chris reminded us a few weeks ago that one of the three hardest things for people to do is to submit to authority. Many people want to rule their own kingdom, have their own power, attain their own glory, and sit on their own throne. Many even want the very throne of God. Today again, we will show that man is totally unqualified for this throne and that only God is worthy to be sovereign over all. In the last few weeks, we have looked at 9 attributes. Let's remind ourselves of these and decide whose throne each belongs to, our throne or God's throne. Attribute number 1 is infinite. Who has no limits, God or man? We humans are measurable. God is not. Who has measured everything? God has. Who has measured God? No one. His power, knowledge, love, and mercy are truly immeasurable, not ours. God's throne earns the infinite attribute. Attribute number 2 is incomprehensible. We as humans can be fully known. He as God is unable to be fully known, but he can be sufficiently known. The only expert on God is God, and this should bring us to worship him. Incomprehensible goes to God's throne. Self-existent, attribute number 3, alludes to a being of infinite creativity. God spoke and the universe leapt into being. From nothing, he creates something. We are his created beings and must confess, I am, because he is. Only God can say, I am who I am. Again, when we look around at his created world, we should be moved to worship the one who made it. Self-existence rightly belongs on his throne. Then there is the attribute of self-sufficiency. God is needed by all, yet he is needful of nothing. Unlike the Energizer Bunny, we humans cannot keep going and going and going. Only God can do that. Our God is a God of no needs. He is sustained by no one. We need him every hour, yet he does not need us at all. Only God is self-sufficient. Attribute number 5 is eternal. Our time is limited here on earth. We have a birth date and a death date. Yet God is the Alpha and the Omega and the one who is, who was, and who is to come. The years have no hold on him, but he determines ours. Eternal is obviously his attribute, not ours. Scripture speaks of a God who does not change, the rock of our salvation that endures forever. God's character is fixed, his plans are steady, and his promises firm. When people and circumstances around us are but shifting sand, our God of infinite sameness is our immutable rock, anchor, and refuge. Immutable belongs on God's throne. The first of the 3 omni-attributes is omnipresent. Since we are created beings, we have a body that is limited to just one location. Our body cannot be in more than one place at a time. Yet God, who is spirit, can be everywhere, and everywhere he is present, he is fully present. This means God is present everywhere, all the time, past, present, and future. There is no place or time where God is not. We cannot outrun his presence, but we can abide and savor his nearness. God's throne gets this attribute too. Attribute number 8 is omniscient, which deals with infinite knowledge. Anyone out there really think they're all-knowing? Not me. God is limitless in his knowledge. We are not. He alone knows all things, and not because he's learned them, but because he is the origin of all knowledge. Our comfort lies not in holding all knowledge, but in trusting the one who does. Attribute number 9, omnipotent. So the questions are, who possesses infinite power? Who can speak and bring order from chaos? The only answer is God. God is all powerful, limitless in power. He never fatigues and is infinitely powerful. His power neither increases or decreases, and it can be exercised anywhere and any time. Jesus demonstrated perfect trust in the strength of his Father. So should we. Each of these 9 attributes allows us to conclude that only God is sovereign over all, which, by the way, is attribute number 10. Only God is worthy of the throne, and his throne is designed to be a place of worship, celebration, trembling, and awe. Only this king is worthy of the throne, and our total allegiance, our obedience, and our humble submission. There is truly none like him, as Jen Wilkin so aptly titled her book. God alone, not us, is sovereign.
I don't know where he is. We're supposed to meet Wes in here, but... Wait, hold on.
Hi, guys. What's up? Sorry I'm late.
Are you here to check out my car? There you go. 2012 blue Mustang, full electric. You get 90 miles to the gallon on this hog.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to my backyard. This is my 1929 Ford Mach-E. It's called a Rat Rod. And what you'll notice is this car has not been painted like all the other nice cars you've seen. This car is supposed to look like it does. It's actually finished. So it's just right. Has just the right amount of rust on it to make it cool. So let me show you what we got. So just a Ford 289, a little tiny engine, three speed. It's not very fast, but it's quick. It'll spin the tires anywhere you want. So when you have a hot rod, that's all you want to do anyways. So it's fun to drive. It's all open and exposed, kind of a roadster style. And original suspension, it's a little bumpy. It kind of bounces up and down depending on the bumps you hit. But inside here is, it's been updated a little bit, lengthened because I'm kind of tall. So I added this little section in here, put some leather seats, and I left the inside like a, kind of like airplane rivets. There's about 2-inch spacing for all the little spot welds, so it looks nice and clean. This isn't the best car for little boys, so I'm not allowed to take the boys in this yet. One day when they grow up, they'll be able to ride in here because there's no seatbelts, all right? So, sorry, Mom. So, but yeah, it's super loud, super cool, gas tank on the back. Pretty basic. I like it basic. I like it dirty. I like it really loud. And it is just so much fun to drive. And the best part, honestly, I can say this, sitting at a light and you can feel people staring at you, it's kind of cool. You look over and people's phones are out like this. So that's kind of a cool feeling because it is a cool car and it's just fun to drive it. So it gets a lot of attention and I like it a lot. I will say, this is my favorite part, you know, is wearing these bad boys when I'm going. So maybe you'll see me out there, maybe not. It is a little scary to drive on the freeway because I could pretty much go under a semi and no one would know. So super fun to drive. So thanks for checking it out. So when you think of a car like this, you see a bunch of different rusted pieces and added pieces and new pieces and old pieces. This car could just as easily a year ago been sitting in a field rusting, finding no purpose. But to me, it makes total sense. It fits. I put the pieces together. I understand how they go. And it makes sense to me. And I'm able to use it and make it a functioning car. And it's even cool the way that it is. It reminds me of 2 Corinthians 5:17, which says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away and the new has come. And when I think about this car, I don't think of a new car, but this is a new car to me. This car might not be painted like the cars you see on the lot, but this car is specific to be the way that it is. This is how it's supposed to look. And I think, you know, all of us in Christ have a past, have an old life that we were dead in our sins and maybe stuck in a different way of life. And God saved us and God changed us. And maybe we were out in that field rusting in the way that we were, but God saved us. God restored us. God made us new from the inside out. And the old passes away and the new comes. And so we're all new in Christ. So when I see this car, it really does make me appreciate that my past is behind me and my future awaits, and all because of Christ. So I just want to encourage you today, just remember that you are new in Christ. What does He have next for you?
Good evening, church family, and happy St. Patrick's Day to you. I made sure to wear green. It's so good to be with you, and I'm delighted to go ahead and lead us in this time of study in Genesis chapter 9. Well, let's go ahead and bow our heads in prayer and ask the Lord to be in our midst. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for such a day, a time as this, Lord, where we can proclaim your truth with confidence, with a living hope of you being faithful to your word. Speak to our hearts now and give us your ears to hear to you. Speak to us as what you have us to do so that we can glorify you and magnify your name in everything that we say and do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we'll be studying in Genesis chapter 9. And, you know, all throughout Scripture, God reveals his plans for our lives, our purpose, and records actual events that impact us to this very day. Now, the book of Genesis is the book of origins and records and records actual events that impact us. And we have seen for the last 9 weeks, in the first nine, we were introduced to the deity of God, the beginning of the heavens and the earth, animal and human life, and all human institutions and relationships. Now, we learn of the birth of sin and the very ruin it brought to fallen man. But thanks be to God, the gospel prevails. You know, the very gospel we believe to this very day by God through Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And so as we begin our journey and study in time of Genesis chapter 9, God sovereignly establishes an intimate relationship through a covenant. We know God as a covenant-keeping God. And all throughout scriptures, in the beginning, even in the book of Genesis, there are four covenants. One of the Edenic covenant, which is found in Genesis chapter 2, verse 16. The Adamic covenant, which is in Genesis 3:15, and the Noahic covenant, which is what we're going to be embarking on, Genesis 9:16. And then also the Abrahamic covenant, which is found in Genesis chapter 12, verse 2. Well, without further ado, let's go ahead and see in chapter 9 how the Adamic covenant is reaffirmed with Noah. And again, Genesis chapter 9, and we'll also have the scripture verses on your screen. So it says, "Then God blessed Noah and his sons and told them, 'Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth.'" And then, verse 8, "Then God told Noah and his sons, 'I hereby confirm my covenant with you and your descendants, and with all the animals that were on the boat with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, every living creature on earth. Yes, I am confirming my covenant with you. Never again will flood waters kill all living creatures. Never again will a flood destroy the earth. All the animals of the earth, all the birds of the sky, all the small animals that scurry along the ground, and all the fish in the sea will look on you with fear and terror. I have placed them in your power. I have given them to you for food, just as I have given you grain and vegetables, but you must never eat any meat that still has the lifeblood in it. Now be fruitful and multiply and repopulate the earth.'" Now you probably are looking the order of the scripture where I'm reading. I wanted to group everything in the order of which we see the Adamic covenant that was established in Genesis chapter 2. Verse 16, and all as well reconfirmed in Genesis 3, how God's word and promise and his desire and longing has always been a wholesome, one of sure relationship with God. And that this being fruitful and multiply has always been God's desire from the start, from the very beginning. And with God institutes the principle of human government and fulfills his promise given in chapter 6 and 8, which we enjoyed last weekend. Now, Adam and Eve represents humankind who willfully fell from the holiness, ignoring the holiness state of God that he blessed us with, and ignored God's warning and an unavoidable death spiritually and physically. You see, the first sin became an emblem of disobedience against God. Instead of listening to the voice of God, humanity gave up its holiness and forfeited a perfect relationship with God. Now let's go to Genesis chapter 9, verse 5 through 6, and it'll be in the right sequential order. And for your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning from every beast. I will require it, and from man. From his fellow man, I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Whoever sheds the blood of man by man, shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. Now, the blood that God is speaking to is of one to where Satan casts war. We see in Genesis 3:15 where God pronounced to Satan, "Hey, you bruised my heel, humanity's heel, and I will crush your head." And the devil longs for bloodshed. At the end of the day, he's a roaring lion seeking to devour. And so this covenant that God is reestablishing with Noah and his sons is of one of importance, simply because remember the story with Cain and Abel, right? With Cain and Abel, Cain was jealous of his brother. He had no right to. He was given the same opportunity to truly enjoy the blessings of God. And he despised the very fact that God accepted the gift of Abel rather than his own gift. And sadly, like all of us, our deceitful hearts, we esteem what we view of importance rather than what God says. And in this, we are influenced by a selfish spirit, an angry spirit, an uncontent, ungrateful spirit, which really the source of that is the devil. And so God gave a fair warning to Cain. Look, sin is crouching at your door. Like, subdue it. And even in that moment was an opportunity for Cain to respond and ask God, like, what do you mean by that? What do you mean subdue it? What do you mean sin is crouching at my door? And I guarantee, knowing the God that we serve, would have revealed and unveiled and given the answer and solution to Cain. But Cain, he loved the created thing rather than the creator. And for this love for his own gain, which really was a blessing from the Lord, his view of it was distorted and unfortunately shed innocent blood, his own very own brother's blood, the very first domestic violence. And so God's response, as we read in 5 and 6, that lifeblood being required and reckoned with. Well, you see, God even reckoned with Cain. Go to Genesis 4:10-11. It says, "And the Lord said, what have you done?" He's having this conversation with Cain. "The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand." And you see, the very sanctity of life, of human life, that God establishes, the blood is a symbol of God's life, God's promise and keeping. And no one has the right to shed innocent blood. No one, regardless of who they are, what they think, it is sin against God. And this very carryover of sin, remember with Adam and Eve, they sowed fig leaves to cover up themselves, and they thought that would be sufficient enough. Well, that was what the devil wanted, this independence of a godless life, all multiplied throughout the earth. And so we read earlier that God established a covenant with Noah, all because Noah found favor, Noah found grace from God, and he was blameless, righteous, and set apart to be used for the glory of God. And by his obedience, his whole family was restored. His whole family was protected from the flood and from the righteous judgment of God. And so, you see, God is in tune and involved and will hold everyone accountable for their actions. God is not mocked concerning his promises. What a man sow, that he will also reap. And we see the sowing in this attack from the devil is of one which multiplied in the earth. And so Satan continues to attack the sacred relationship God instituted, along with the sign God has given of his grace, the rainbow, which by God's design, even though the devil continues to attack Adam and Eve and their union, their perfect union with God, and then also with their children, the attacks, the devil is always attacking in the sacred things that God has designed and blessed us with. And so though society puts pressure on us, though society belittles marriage, marriage is a gift from God. Marriage is the same type of favor that Noah found and enjoy, and like one of with Enoch, who walked with God and walked in fellowship with God, and he was raptured right away in the presence of God. It's because God declared these individuals who he used, this covenant of promise, an agreement between two or more, that what God says and the standard that he has set is sufficient, and there's no contesting it. And so I would say this much, even with the pressure from this world, the pressure from this day and age, by God's design, marriage is favor from God between male and female. And that's what the Word of God says. From the beginning, from times past, to this very day, and until heaven and earth pass away, God's Word will stand forever. And so we declare and say, let God be true and man a liar. And so we feel the last couple of weeks, we even in the First Peter sermon passages where we find our living hope is in Christ Jesus alone. This very fulfillment of God's word from the beginning is Jesus, our living hope, acting upon what God has promised from the beginning. And as I said earlier, this God who we serve, who is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, will be victorious. And so Satan and his demons and those who willfully reject God will continue to attempt to destroy God's gift of holy matrimony. Now, God actually gave us, our church family, a sign just a couple weeks ago, March 5th and 6th. We enjoyed the marriage conference. And, you know, the title of the marriage conference was titled Exhale, right? And exhale, like, what that is exactly is life. That is life, right? And so God was able to breathe on the hearts and lives of couples who are taking a stand, even in this day, pressured by the world, unforsaken by, you know, false claims and the diminishing of the purpose of the holy matrimony of God, which points to God's promise to redeem his church. We stood together, we worshiped and praised God. You know, we sought the Lord, seeking him to bring about healing and restoration in the hearts and lives of our relationships. And through Bible teaching and encouraging, motivated by the word of God and prayer, that the Lord will help us and give us the strength to apply what we have learned. Well, the couples who attended, I was there personally with my wife, we were reminded that the pressure of the world, the difficulties of the world, and the responsibilities of this world, those feel like flood waters, but yet we are covered in the warm embrace and protection and shield in the blood of Jesus Christ. And this is that same covering that was extended to Noah and his family. And so as the flood waters of life that, you know, rock and rock us back and forth, God says with his word, with his powerful word, peace be still. I pray that we all are enjoying the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, and accept that the gift of God, the peace of God, is through Jesus Christ alone. Now, let's go to Genesis chapter 9, verse 12 through 29, and we'll continue on in seeing this sign, this promise of God. See, what God reveals, though Satan, puts up blinders and deceives the nation and lies and distorts truth, God unveils, God gives truth, and that very truth is something that is not that God forgot these promises, or he doesn't forget that, oh, yeah, the flood took place, and, you know, that's right, that's there because, no, we are the ones that are lacking in understanding. God is omniscient, and so he sets these boundaries and establishes these symbols in order for us to remember. Think about the children of Israel at a point in time with the passing of the torch from Moses to Joshua, and then thereafter after Joshua passed, and all those leaders who were there with Joshua who remembered the Exodus, who remember that God gave them the testimony and the word of God, that there came a generation who did not know from the beginning the truth of God and the covenant and all these other type of things, and began to believe and a lie, and were deceived. And we saw every single time throughout the judges, unless a judge was there that God appointed and set apart and gave them the word to lead and guide them in the power and was with them, the children of Israel were in bondage. They were devastated. And we're thankful that, as we read verse 12 here, "Behold, I established my covenant with you, you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you. As many as come out of the ark, it is for every beast of the earth. I establish my covenant with you." You see who's doing the talking here. This is God. "That never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said," here's that covenant, "this is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh." Now, this covenant, this bow in the cloud, is once again, like I said, not a reminder for God, but it is a pointing to that God keeps his promises, and for us to never forget what God has through his word revealed to us, so that we won't be comfortless, so that we can know the truth. And as the scripture says, the truth of God will set us free. Now, even to this very day, we enjoyed some spotty showers, cloud skies, and, you know, now I was looking, personally looking, especially for this time of study, for that rainbow. Now, I may have missed it. Yeah, I probably mistimed the opportunity when the rainbow was out there, but I remember seeing it many, many times, to where out there it's rained, and the Lord has caused a refreshness and a cleansing of our land, and especially we need it in our wilderness. I mean, the desert, California desert, baby, AV. But God meets those needs, and he provides, and he still has not devastated and gone against his promise. He has fulfilled that promise, and though we've seen disasters, you know, through weather, we're still here living to this very day, which is a revelation for us that we can believe everything that God has said, and thankful that he fulfills his promises. So when the boat is in the clouds, I will set it in reminder. I will set it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. God said to Noah, This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth. So the sons of Noah who went forth from the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. These three were the sons of Noah, and from these the people of the whole earth were dispersed. So we see God's intention, God's promise to Noah, declared right before Noah, all because of his obedience. And if we go back to Genesis chapter 8, verse 15, then God said to Noah, "Go out from the ark, you and your wife and your sons' wives with you. Bring out with you every living thing that is with you of all flesh, birds and animals and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, that they may swarm on the earth and be fruitful and multiply on the earth." So Noah went out and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him. Every beast, every creeping thing, every bird, everything that moves on the earth went out by families from the ark. And so we see this promise that God is in agreement with Noah and his family. We see Noah's example. Noah didn't just jump the gun, open up the door, and ran out and check and see if the waters were, had receded. But he waited for the Lord. A simple waiting for God's guidance and God's sign to say, green light, go, St. Patrick's Day, huh? Green light, go, and multiply on the earth. Noah did it at the time that God told him to do it. And so his family responded, and his kids responded, and their wives responded in an act of obedience. No wonder God wanted Noah and his sons to be fruitful and to multiply, because the commitment to the precise detail that God gave, Noah responded in obedience. And so in closing, we see Noah began to be a man of the soil, and he planted a vineyard. He drank of the wine and became drunk and lay uncovered in his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brothers outside. So we see here the continuance of sin. The all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God as we know it was even evident to this day. And though Noah found favor with God, he found favor because of his faith to act upon what God revealed as instructions. God accounted him righteous, which is also a reflection of when in Christ Jesus, whoever believes in the Lord Jesus is saved and are justified and reconciled with God, sanctified with God. And we see here, here's Ham in an opportunity to be fruitful in the situation to cover his father. Just like he forgot, similar to what we were talking about with the Israelites, forgetting what God had done. Well, how was it that Ham forgot right there in that incident, in that moment, that, wait, I'm covered because the relationship my father had with God. And I see him in a vulnerable moment, and I'm not going to do something about it. And that's just our depravity, our sinful nature. And I'm not diminishing the lack of his response to this, but it is a revelation of our hearts. And it points to why we need a Savior. Here he is in this moment. Has just turned a blind eye to a situation, and entrusted someone else to come along and do it. But the good news is, who's the one? Who's the spirit of that is on the move to cover their father? That is the Spirit of God, and because of their act of obedience, the simple response in obedience to the situation that was presented to them. The opportunity to have dominion over the situation led by God, they covered their father. And it's amazing how they did it. It was one of respect, one of not wanting to disrespect their father, who they appreciated by his life that they'd been covered. And so with that, we see Noah's response. It was as one of with God, and his response with wickedness and violence and corruption on the earth. You see, this small blemish, and it's not just a small blemish, it is a big blemish that God sees. And so in our eyes it might be a mote, but it is a beam in the eyes of the fact of even the cross. See, it takes the cross to cover us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And this covering, Jesus Christ, God, through these two sons, come and cover their father. And that was the intention of the institution of family and relationships. Not one of Cain and Abel, with Cain, where he struck his brother, who that relationship was given for his help, for his benefit, for his success, and to really enjoy life. And so, though our relationships, how that does it apply to us? How does this apply to us? Well, we know the scripture verses about the Good Samaritan, and you know, are we those individuals who know the Word of God, see a situation, and turn a blind eye to it? Kind of like with what's going on even in this day and age, with the people waxing worse and worse, and just forsaking any instruction and any willingness to submit to God. Do we turn a blind eye to it, or do we take a stand for righteousness? Do we cover someone else and take a stand to be what God has called us to be? Because that is exactly what God would want us to do. But when we don't do that, we see the response even from Noah. He says, when Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his youngest son had done to him, he said, cursed be Canaan. So curse his son, a servant of servants shall he be to his brothers. He also said, but blessed be the Lord, the God of Shem. Here is Noah being reminded of the covering and the protection of God through his son, through his seed, through his children. And that very promise that God said would be fulfilled to the next generation would be established in Shem and Japheth. And with that, you see, let Canaan, the son of Ham, be his servant. Now, may God enlarge Japheth and let him dwell in tents of Shem, and let Canaan be his servant after the flood. So after the flood, Noah lived 350 years. All the days of Noah were 950 years, and Noah died. Now, how does that apply to us? Well, in 1 Peter chapter 5, we have this account of and warning by Peter to call us to a humbleness, to a surrendering to the mighty hand of God, one of responding with the right response to the situation that's placed before us, that is entrusted to us, to do it under the authority and the leadership of God. Because when we do this, there's just this protection and covering and safety. So in closing, so humble yourselves under the mighty power of God, and at the right time, he will lift you up in honor. You see, Noah was lifted up in honor by his two sons, Shem and Japheth. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you. And here's the warning. Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. So we know the source of our opposition. It is not God, but it is the sinful nature of our hearts that is deceitfully wicked and desperately desperately wicked, and yet our arch enemy, which is the devil, who's seeking to destroy us. He is our great enemy. And the devil, he is the one who prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Stand firm. How do we overcome? Stand firm against him. How? In the covering of God, being strong in your faith, being strong in what God revealed, that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Remember that your family of believers all over the world is going through the same kind of suffering you are. In his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus, So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you, and he will place you on a firm foundation. All power to him forever. Amen. And so 1 Peter just told the whole story of Genesis chapter 9, the humbling of Noah to obey God's word, the humbling of the family to follow and obey, the response, even when Noah fell into sin, and the covering of God. See, God still appointed him and declared him righteous and knew that he was going to fall short there, but then gave him a opportunity to be renewed and be reconciled with God. And it just so happened to be his children. And what a blessing. And so for us as the children of God, as brothers and sisters in Christ, let us be committed. Let us cherish the beautiful gift of salvation. This journey of starting from the beginning and taking the time and seeing how the gospel resonates all throughout Scripture and leads up to a heart that should be of one of gratitude and thankfulness for what God has done. And so I'd ask, are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, or are they white as snow? Are they washed in the blood of the Lamb? You see this Ark of Covenant, this protection from death and eternal separation from God is through Jesus Christ alone. Well, God bless you, church family. Thank you for this time. Let's thank the Lord for this time of study. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness. Thank you for the truth of your word that is timeless, that is always in season and out of season, able to cause us to know who you are and give us the guidance and direction that we should go. Help us by your Holy Spirit alone to be able to overcome the fiery darts of the devil and put on all that you provided us, Lord, which is your armor that you will equip us and remind us of our salvation and the blessed hope that we have in you. We thank you from the start and from the fact that you are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and our hope and trust is in you alone. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Precious blood has left me forgiven, pure like the whitest of snow, powerful to make sin and shame retreat. His covenant is making me whole. Precious blood has left me forgiven.
That was a fun night.
That was a really fun night.
It really was. What a blessing.
David did a great job. It was a blessing.
You know, David McCoy, it seriously is probably one of the most sincere men I've ever met. Just heart full of a love for Jesus and his love for his family. Today we are on our staff meeting that we do by Zoom still at this point. And his little girl came up and was showing him her certificate that she had just gotten for something she had completed for school. And he showed it to everybody, and we all waved to her. And she goes, "See," he said, "see, all of the staff, they're really proud of you." You know, and I just think, what a neat dad.
That's really
sweet.
What a
dear brother in Christ. And David, thank you for sharing. And Weston and Debbie as well. We have
a nice night.
Blessed church family. We're thankful. Well, you want to tell us who our winners are for tonight?
I sure do. Okay, so the getting pinched answer went to Kristen Villanueva.
Hey,
I bet her
right.
girls helped answer that question. And this number two, the lucky number was four, and it was for Debbie Kuhn.
All right, Debbie, bless you.
Number three, the leprechaun in a pot of gold, was for Janice Zark. Good
Hello,
job.
Hello, Zarks, by the way.
Yes. And the last one, which you like corned beef, don't you?
I do. You know what I love most? It's corned
beef
hash.
That's what it is.
It's right up there with Spam and eggs. It's good stuff. You know where corned beef hash is best, though, is when you're camping.
Yes.
It's the only really good thing about camping.
Well, the winner is Leah Farisoli. Good job, everybody.
Good job, Leah. You know,
good job.
We are almost back on Wednesdays. That's going to be a joy.
Yes, it is.
But this has been a blessing. But just so you know, April 7th, we're going to be back here on campus, and we'll have men's and women's Bible studies and opportunities for youth, and Awana will start back up in full swing. You know, kind of the thinking is on that is we'll do a 10-week, you know, sort of season of adult ministry in Awana, and then we'll go into summer in the sun. That takes us to about the middle of June from April 7th. And by the way, Easter is on the way. It's April 4th.
I know.
And that weekend, we have a weekend full of services. Good Friday, we'll have two services at 5:30 and 7. We'll live stream the 7 o'clock service from the worship center. And then Saturday, we have a whole bunch of services. You'll have to look them up. But nonetheless, I don't want to start quoting the times. I think it's 4 outside, 5:30 inside, 7 o'clock inside. And then Easter morning, 8, 9:30, and 11.
Wow, so how fun.
Lots of opportunities to come and worship together. And the 9:30 service on Easter will be live streamed from the worship center. We've added new equipment. You might see that in your Easter letter that you got where all these times are listed, there is an opportunity for you to maybe give if you'd like to. We upgraded the equipment so that we can effectively live stream in there. We've added a booth, and we still have this equipment on order. So if you feel led to give toward that, that would be a great blessing. Did I miss anything else?
Nope, that's
it. Are we
good? Yes, we're good, except you have a wardrobe change. Are you going to a wedding?
I have a, oh, you know, yeah, actually, some of you, I just thought, well, I'll go ahead and I'm going to change after, because I've been asked to do kind of like a presentation for an event going on here locally, and they wanted me to record something for them. So I was already going to change, but I thought, well, I'll just change and see if anybody notices.
Yeah, you look nice.
Well, it is a blessing being with you guys. We love you. We'd love to see you this weekend at church. If you're able to come, we have a meeting outside at 4:00 in the Tabernacle. And what a joy that is, and 5:15, and then Sunday morning at 9:15 and 11. And we will live stream at 10:00 as well this week. So come join us if you're able. If not, join us on the live stream.
And don't forget, tomorrow is GC Kids at 4, and Friday is the senior hour at 10 a.m.
We love you. It's a blessing being with you tonight. Be encouraged in Christ.
Good night, everyone.
As I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I will fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is the cross, God, you see the empty tomb. That'll be nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow. The battle belongs to you.
battle.